This is the Heckheld 32. And in this video, I want to go over the hardware, what I added, what I changed, what's working, what's not working. So the Heckheld 32 is this physical piece of device, and the D of the 32 is the software or the firmware that's running on it. And both are successors to previous projects. So here we have the Heckheld Vega 2. This is the one I'm currently selling in my store, and it's running the ESP8266 D offer. Most people buy it as a kit for soldering, because the cool thing about this design is it's pretty simple. You only need the development board, a screen, some buttons, that's it, and it's fairly cheap. This presented me with quite the challenge. Can I replicate this with modern hardware so we can also add some modern features? If you're interested in the firmware and what it can currently do, you can watch my video about this D-Stike D of the 32 watch that I recently made. I go over the firmware and all of its features and menus in that video. Because today I want to focus on the hardware aspect. I'm developing my own device to be able to make something that's open source and accessible and affordable to as many people as possible. Whether I will be able to reach this goal as good as I did with the Heckheld Vega, I'm not sure. But now let's go over the hardware. As you can see, both the dimensions and the layout itself is pretty similar. So here we have a monochrome OLED screen, and here we have a bigger, more high resolution, full color IPS LCD screen, which allows for a much nicer UI than on the old version. But buttons and the LED remain the same. If we look at the backside, the differences are more clearly visible. Here we have the ESP8266 D1 Mini development board that sits at the heart of the whole device. This particular Heckheld has the battery mod installed, however, this is optional. And on the new version, pretty much same setup. We have the Lowlin board here, however, this is the S3 Mini version. So we have an ESP32 S3, which has a lot more power, a lot more memory, and allows for cool features like bad USB attacks. The battery mod is also installed here, and here you can actually see the battery. And this is a GPS module that you can actually remove if you want. So this is also optional. The idea behind this was to keep the cost down as much as possible. So if you want, you could build this without battery, without GPS module, and then it's very similarly priced as the current Heckheld Vega. This is the first version of the new Heckheld 32 that I designed, and as you can see, I needed to add a lot of botch wires to make it work. The SD card slot is new, of course. So if I sell this as a DIY kit, the PCB has to come pre-assembled with some of the components. Not really a deal breaker, but of course not as simple as the old design. I guess it has pros and cons. Pro is you get a micro SD card. Another con is that you have to solder all of those pins. I think it's like 32 or something. If you cut the pins off here, then you can solder them more easily. Something I learned along the way, not on this version. Here we have a newer iteration. We have the pin header here for the GPS. This is where the development board goes, SD card slot. And here we also have a expansion header. So you could develop add-ons for this device or connect other peripherals, whatever you want. And then we also have this little quick connector for connecting I2C devices. And then this is where the screen goes, the buttons and the LED. Here you can see some of the design revisions I made. This was the first design, pretty simple. Here I fixed the pins, and here I added a bunch of stuff like the pin header, this connector. We have pads here for the battery add-on, the same that I use on the old Heckheld. And I tried to move the pin header here to the right. Didn't really work out the way I wanted it to. So this is basically where we are now. And yeah, this is the result. All of these were made from JLC PCB, who are kindly sponsoring this video. So they manufacture not just the PCB itself, but they can also assemble them for you. They are very reliable, very easy to use. I also use them for some of the 3D printed cases that I made, especially the transparent ones. Ordering is pretty simple. If you designed your PCB and you have the Gerber files, then you can just upload them to the site. You get an instant quote. You can select a bunch of options. Even the assembly service is pretty affordable and fast. Check out the video description for a link and some extra coupons. You can get up to 8-layer PCBs for just $2. And they have a special going on for 6-layer PCBs and $30 off. Thanks JCPCB for making these and also sponsoring my video. And now let's go over some more hack heads. Here you see a few different versions I made. We have different PCB colors, different case options. I like this. You don't really see the mess that's going on there, but I also quite like the fully transparent ones, though it shows the mess that's happening in there, which I guess can be a choice if you like that. Of course, if you assemble all of it, it's a bit messy, right? The GPS only fits because it sits on top of the development board, which works fine. That's not an issue. And I actually quite like it that you can connect and disconnect it, because this gives us another expansion header. If you want, you could connect something else here. This is a serial connection. So if you have something else that works over TX and RX, you could connect that here, but it fits. I quite like it, and considering that the battery and the GPS is optional, the minimum required parts are not that much more expensive than for the old hack head. But you still get the microSD card slot here on the side, right? And you get the new chip, the fancy UI, all of those new capabilities that come with the new firmware. As a DIY kit, it would look something like this. The case, the screen, the development board, the PCB, everything you need. Yes, it's a bit messy. This is just for showcasing. Here you can see a earlier proof of concept that I made for packet sniffing. It captures the Wi-Fi traffic on, in this case, channel 1 on the microSD card, and then you can connect this to the computer and have a look at the traffic in Wireshark. But yeah, I also added these little holes here for a wristband or lanyard or whatever. One thing you can notice on all of these is, of course, that they are thicker than the old Heckelt Vega. But however, this is pretty much unavoidable since we have the GPS module here and we also want space for the battery and everything. I think it's a trade-off worth having. I have a bunch of more ideas. The problems are like the GPS antenna not being at the perfect place. I'm currently trying to solve in a redesign, which looks like this. But I will talk more about that in my next video. If you want to learn more about the D-Offer and the Heckheld, I will also have links in the description for that. I'm currently working on a new documentation site you can check out. In the meantime, let me know what you think of this design, if you like it, if you don't like it, if you want to see something change, if you have any ideas, or maybe you do want a version that's completely pre-assembled. In that case, wait for my next video. And if you're just here to tell me that you want a 5 GHz D-Offer, then I have a video coming up about that as well. Thanks for watching. Check out the links in the description. Check out my other videos. Like, subscribe, whatever. Goodbye.